This presentation is about the Final LRH Library, dedicated to L. Ron Hubbard. LRH demanded from us to use source, not offshoots. But we know today that we have interpretations and older is by RCC and CST. So how to sort out the wheat from the chaff? My name is Andreas Groß. I live with my family in Switzerland. I wear three hats. I'm investigative writer and author. I'm a civil engineer in computers, specialized on databases and websites. And I'm class 6 auditor and Dynalytics auditor. Here you see me in front of my Hardcopy Library. Details of this library. But this is not enough. A lot of issues are missing. So I also own a digital LRH collection on an 8 terabyte hard drive. LRH demanded from us to set up a Qual library. The org library ideally contains two copies of everything that has ever been issued. Books, tapes, policies, technology, packs, manuals, and so on. Two copies of everything that has ever been issued. So also the old issues. The ones which have been replaced by newer ones. He also tells this in this lecture, 5th of September, 71. He said, and you just get your hands on at least two of every pack on tech or policy or anything else that has ever been issued. With this collection of even the old original issues, the non-revised and every new revision, well, this will help us to sort out the wheat and from the chaff. We got these nice new books in 2007, but what about the original ones? They have been destroyed because RTC is the BOTVO squirrel. BOTVO is an acronym based on the works of, for example, the life improvement courses are based on the works of LRH. Since 1972, we find a lot of non-LRH scroll issues. It's not the golden age of management, it's a furry age of management, the scroll management. How do we apply KSW? Newspaper editors are men who separate the wheat from the chaff and then print the chaff. And that's also the concept of RTC. They present us the golden age of tech, new volumes since 1991. But what is with the old volumes? Some bought them in eBay. But not everyone is able to buy such a set. It's not enough. So we digitalized these volumes and a lot of other material and have them on our hard drive. But these are so many millions of files. How to solve the confusion? We can solve it with an online community. I want to promote this community. One place for our Qual library online, where you can easily find each issue, also the original and all revisions, with discussion threads for each single issue, arguments and warnings about squill issues, counter-arguments, why there is a worth in it. You can finally make up your own mind after reading all arguments. First, I want to show what I already have. I call this database eBib for LRH Electrical Bibliotheca. It was created since 2000 under Windows with Microsoft Access as a desktop software, organizing 100,000 documents. To show you my solution, we have to agree upon a few definitions I use here. Definition of work. A creative work is a manifestation of creative effort, including fine artwork like sculpture, paintings, drawing, sketching, performance art, dance, writing, literature, lecturing, filmmaking, and musical composition. The term is frequently used in the context of copyright. So we are talking about the works of LRH. LRH created thousands of works. Each bulletin, each book, each lecture is one work. And now the definition of issue. I will present examples of issues of the same original work. We have the original, reissues, revisions, translations, digitalizations, corrections, and fakes of one work. There are a lot of items I call issues related to one work. Each work has several issues. For example, I give 12 examples for issues. First, LRH writes a manuscript of an HCOPL. This is the HCOPL 7th of February 1965, originally written as a bulletin, later issued as policy. That's a famous KSW1. The secretary has to type it so that it could be printed and published as an HCOPL. It's another issue. It's not the original manuscript. It's a copy of the manuscript, a typed one. 5 years later, the issue was reissued as a loose leaf in 1970. Here you see the note, which shows that it is not the same text as 5 years ago. Later, the PubSorg published it in the OEC volume 0, the first printing, I think that was 72 or such, the basic stuff volume. Then, a year later, the issue got corrected in 73. Corrected per flag issue 28, January 73. It's another issue, not the same as the original. Then I skip some steps of the history of this policy. This policy. RTC revised and republished the volume in 1991. Someone scanned this issue and created an image file and distributed this so that we can own a copy on our computer. The 8th issue is someone or you OCR this is image to get an editable document, a text document for MS Word. Another one used this text file of the revised HCUB or HCPL and created an unrevised issue comparing it to the 1970 issue. So he made a copy and deleted some additions to regain a text file in the way as it was 1970. It's another issue. Then someone made a PDF from the Word file so that he can use it on his tablet. But it's unclear which file he used for this, whether it was the 70 version or the 91 version or whatever, because he did not mention it. Then this issue was translated into other languages. Here we have a course pack, KSW in German. So we have an 11th issue of the same policy. Then someone corrects in this translation. He found some typos, corrected them and saved it again, made a new file out of it, and we see here the file got a new date, has a bigger size, but a similar file name. If you copy these two files, the original one, created 2007, and the new one, from today, 2019, and copy this to a Windows machine, you would finally get just one of the files, because for Windows these two names are identical. I work with a Linux system, and so the uppercase name is differentiated to the lowercase name. It's two different files here and will end up as one file on Windows. This creates some trouble. And you don't know which is what, which is the better one, the corrected one, without the typos. So, Here I show again a list of the 12 examples, 12 issues of the same original work. The 12 I just explained, it's just for your reference here again. I don't go over it again. So, intelligence is the ability to differentiate. Differentiation, association, and identification are the three Scientology concepts that explain how man processes data. These concepts form a scale of knowingness from full knowingness to unknowingness. Differentiation is at the top of the tone scale and is a condition of the highest level of sanity and individuality. Differentiation is the action of observing the differences and similarities between items, people, and ideas. In our case, we differentiate between issues. It's very important to know the difference between the issues. You're to find originals, revisions, legitimate revisions by LRH and illegitimate one, fake issues, which lead us into a dead end, into a black Scientology. The differentiation in the library, we have to differentiate between these three concepts. The work of the author, which is usually the manuscript or the original lecture, which is already gone, not available anymore. Then the many issues of one work, the revisions, the translations, the digitalizations, different file formats. Even if we have an original tape of an LH lecture, then it is not the original work, it's a copy of the work. It's the first issue. And files. Files are not identical with the issues. Not for all issues we have a file, because some issues are in a tape format or a book or a leaf, just a paper or cassette, CD, CD-ROM or whatever. Yeah, then we can have files based on these issues. How can we identify a file? Different files may have the same file name, which is quite confusing. We expect a file name to identify a file. But sometimes files are different and the file name is the same. But happens often if you open a text file with, let's say, an LRH lecture and listen to the lecture, read the text, the transcript, and then find a mistake in the transcript. You listen to the tape and hear the word right, so you correct this text, type in the correct word, and save the file with the same file name, then you have created another file, a new file, which is more valuable than the original one. Even if you overwrite the original one so that this one is lost on your collection, other people will have the same old file and will not easily recognize that you made a better run. So, second step in this list, the same file, identical content, byte for byte, identical, may have different attributes like different file names, different file dates. Someone could rename the file so that it has a different file name, perhaps to clear up what this file is about. And if you copy the files from one file system to another, it might be that in the process of the copying, all the new files get the current date, and you did not copy the original date. So the date might not help. You think they are different because they have a different date, but they are not. They are identical. Just copied. The file size, that might help, because if the length of the file in bytes is identical, then it may indicate the same file. But that is not always true. So, how can we identify a file? We want to have a file ID, like a fingerprint for a file, which is unique for every single file. This problem has already been solved by programmers. They call it fingerprints for files. Programmers found a solution for the problem to identify a file, to differentiate very similar looking files even if just one comma is missing. The technique is called hash codes. Examples are MDE5, which is old, should not be used anymore, and SHA2, or similar methods. For example, the very popular file dmsmh.plir has this ID. It's a long string of hexadecimal digits, so all the digits from 0 to 9 plus A, B, C, D, E, F. This string identifies this file. If I change only one bit in this file, it will get a different ID. So if I investigate files and find a file with this ID, whether it has the same name or not, can be quite sure that it is the same Dynetics book as a PDF format. So we use SHA-256. It's my suggestion to use this to identify our files. The software like SHA-256 sum is available for all computers, Windows, Linux, and Apples. With one command, you create a list of all files on your hard drive with their fingerprint. This might need a few hours in case of a terabyte file collection, but finally you have a list with the fingerprints. The file, with all the file names and fingerprints, might be a few megabytes, 100 megabytes large, but can be opened by text editors. Don't open it with Word or so. Use a pure ASCII text editor. Then you can take a look. It would look like this. In the left column you see the fingerprint. On the right column you see the path. Yeah. Why don't you see the file name? It should be also visible. Yeah. So, I showed you the fingerprint of the DMSMH book. And I will show you what I found in my list. I found the same file 18 times in my collection. It's the same file. Here's the fingerprint. And here the path and the file name. And here we see this is a short file name and someone renamed it to Dynetics, the Modern Science of Mental Health .php. Then in another collection, this was my series collection, then I have a torrent collection. And Russia archive also has it. But here someone has renamed it to Dynetics 50. But it's the same file, proven by the fingerprint. And then another CBR, Northern Germany collection, has the same file. Maxim, I think Russian Maxim, has the same file twice. In two names, same book, same file. The runs of Tech CD, which is a very old one from 20 years ago, is it? And Scientologypedia.org has also the book twice with two different names. And from another friend, I got it. Four times. IFA has it. The original way. And another one from the Runs Org. I found it here. So I have this 18 times. Same book. Three different file names in 10 different collections by 10 different collectors, 1 megabyte each nearly. So that's my mistake, must be 17 megabyte redundancy, 90% redundancy or 95% redundancy. I could save a lot of hard drive if I get rid of all the double files. I come back to this later. I will create a software which helps to get rid of the double files. Another problem. A lot of file names contain dates, the date when this issue was created. And here I give the examples I found, real existing examples in files I had. The date is always the same, but in a different format. I have here English version, French version, then with the AD 10 instead of 60, which is the short form of 60 and abbreviated month, or different ways to write it. Some take the short form or the way around. For letters for the year, for this version, that's the way LH established for lectures. Could also be written like this, or this, or this. Or this American way to write a date with a June in the beginning, and then the day, and then the year. Or like this. So, you can find all these different versions in your collections. And it would be a lot of work to go through a million files and correct this so that you are able to look up files which you're looking for. I usually use this I version. Two letters for the year, directly behind it two letters for the month and two letters for the day. I use this because if you start with this date in the file name and look up your directory, the whole directory, then all files will be sorted chronological. So, but it would be months of work to go through all the million files I have and correct these so that the files become available. But I have another solution. I developed a software which takes the file name and goes through the file name and find the dates, and then adds this date to my database. So in this way, the database makes the files available without renaming the file name. I don't touch the file name, I don't change it, but I calculate the date, the original date of the work, to my data collection. So people found a solution to add attributes to the file, to the text. In the early times of our computers, we had just 8 letters to name a file, plus a 3-letter extension. So 8 letters was just possible to say B for bulletin, D for German, and then 6 letters for the date, and that's it. No title, nothing. It's finally we got longer file names and directories and folder names. So people started to organize their collections. And people have different priorities how to organize files in a hierarchical folder structure or folder tree. I will give some examples for the same file, how different people would organize them on their hard drive. Somebody, maybe in Switzerland, supporting his German, French or Italian-speaking students, would organize his files like this, to be able to copy all files from one language for the student with one command. So he starts at the top with the language, German, French, English, Italian. And then he differentiates between LH, CBR, David Mayo, or whoever And then he has course packs or bulletins, books or such. And then the single files below this. Perhaps below course packs you would make another folder for each level, so that he has for each level one folder and could put multiple files into it. That would be one idea, one solution. Another course supervisor in the USA who is not so aware about the importance of other languages would prefer to organize the material per levels to be able to copy with one command all needed material for each level as the student progresses. So you would have a folder OT3, then LRH or CBR, then English or French or whatever, and then the file itself. The next one might find highest priority in dividing his materials by author to keep material from CBR or Mario separate from LH. Could be looked like this. Another one sees the priority to keep confidential materials from non-confidential ones, so he can give away all the material to lower bridge students with one mouse click. Then he would have a folder confidential and non-confidential at the top. And by putting this at the top, he must not risk to give confidential material to people who are not prepared for it. So what we see is to identify a work we are looking for, an issue especially, we need attributes, or computer freaks call it metadata, like we need the author, a date, a title, a type, perhaps a level in the bridge where this reference applies to, or the series where it is part of, whether it's confidential or not, or the language, English, French, German. Perhaps we want to know who is the publisher. Was it PubsOrg or New Era, or the Free Zone Bible Association, or OneSorg or whatever? Is it a revision, or original, or a reissue, or the 10th revision? Who is the translator, if it is in another language? And of course the file format, so that we know with which software we can open. These are attributes, and until now people put these attributes into the file name and folder, and this creates the trouble, because folders named by attribute cannot overcome confusion. I recently downloaded 68,000 files, 47 gigabyte, from a Russian website in 1,800 folders. If you need on the average a minute to move every file to its place in your folder structure, you would need over 1,000 hours. With an hour each evening, you would need more than 3 years just to organize your new download. It's not possible anymore. I have 10 major free zone collections with 1.48 million files. If I tried to consolidate this, put it into my folder structure, sort out doubles and so on, it would take me 68 years. And a file a minute is very quick. I doubt that this is enough, that people could work so quick. So it's not possible. Conclusion: everyone organizing his files by folder does not achieve a solution, but creates another collection, and with this even more confusion. What is the real solution for us? I suggest, let us work in an international team. Keep your collections as they are. Stop moving files around. I mean, into other folders. Stop renaming files. Calculate a fingerprint and a file ID for each file, and enter these data to our common database. Attach to this record as many attributes as you like. Retrieve the document or file by choosing or selecting the attributes. So, to find a certain reference, you enter in the database. It's a HCOB. It is from the 10th August 1973, and the system gives you back the document. That's a solution. Don't care how it is named, don't care where it is stored, in which folder. This work will be done by the computer. This is no theory. I did it and it works. I started with this approach in 2000, 19 years ago, with a Microsoft Access database in Windows. I added 13,000 works from 287 authors, 22,000 issues in 61 languages. I have altogether 1.5 million files from dozens of collections on a 7 terabyte external hard drive. 1.5 terabyte is used. The rest is still free. I will show you a video about my database. Remember, this is an old software, not up to date. It runs on Windows XP, which I do not use anymore. It is old, unsupported, faulty. I moved to Linux, Ubuntu. So, this project should be migrated to a modern database on an internet server with access for everyone who wants to contribute to it. Now, we switch to Windows.